WFYI podcast brought to you by Bloomington, Indiana, an American college town offering food and drink, college sports, outdoor activities, live music, cool art, and good times daily. Everyone is welcome in Bloomington. More information at visitbloomington.com.
We're going to take a trip right now. Like we always do about this time.
This is a journey into sound.
Break it down.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. On this week's show, we'll discuss the past, present, and future of Indianapolis R&B music. I'll be joined by Sid Johnson, a veteran Indianapolis artist manager, music journalist, and songwriter. Johnson has co-written hit songs, including Slow Jam by Midnight Star and Two Occasions by the Deele. In 2020, Johnson's contributions to R&B music were recognized nationally when he was inducted into the Soul Music Hall of Fame. Johnson is also the founder and director of M.E.C.A.P., an independent record label and artist management company, and will be joined by two of the Indianapolis artists Johnson represents, vocalist Damon Karl and the vocal group Forecast. But first, I want to remind you that we're in the middle of our spring membership drive here at WFYI. And this year, we have a special thank you gift for listeners who support this station. A limited edition 45 RPM single featuring a lost recording by the legendary Indianapolis R&B group, The Vanguards. You can get a copy of this rare disc when you become a member of this station at wfyi.org/give. It's listeners like you that make local programs like Cultural Manifesto and Echoes of Indiana Avenue possible. And it was your support that led to the discovery of this lost Vanguards recording. I'm going to share that song on this week's show, but first, I want to give you a bit of the backstory behind this recording. The Vanguards were signed to the Indianapolis label Lamp Records. Lamp has been called Naptown's Motown. It was a black-owned company that issued funk and soul recordings from local bands. The label was founded in 1969 by a young Indianapolis firefighter named Herb Miller. The Vanguards were the first group Miller signed to the label, and their debut single, Somebody Please, was a national hit. And over the years, Somebody Please has become an enduring classic of R&B music. During my time at WFYI, I've extensively researched the history of Herb Miller, Lamp Records, and the Vanguards. And while doing that research, I uncovered this lost demo recording from the Vanguards. I recently had an opportunity to discuss this recording with Lamp's founder, Herb Miller. And he told me he knew the Vanguards were special the first time he saw them perform. I think you told me you first saw the Vanguards in this neighborhood. There was a nightclub on 16th Street, very near our radio studio here, called Dave's Lounge, that the Vanguards used to perform in. What do you remember about the early interactions?
We kind of hit it off from the beginning. And I saw them. I loved the music and figured, you know, this will be our starting point. If I can get them, then we can move forward. So that's how it all started. Dave's Lounge, 16th and Northwestern. Mm-hmm. On the northeast corner, it's where it was, next to the car wash.
This was the group that took Lamp Records national, right? They had two hit records. They were the first group to record for you. You had a close relationship with the group's founder. Tell me about the Vanguards and your relationship with the group's founder, James Davis.
James and I were friends from the beginning. James, of course, you know, was phenomenal. He was a great personality and a good person to communicate with. James did not force the music. In other words, he wrote it, a lot of the songs were from his heart. and he wanted to go forward, but in the right way. The Vanguards as a group were easy to work with, and we got along great.
Somebody Please was written by the Vanguard's lead vocalist, James Davis. In 2017, I spoke with Davis, and he recalled the group's journey to success.
The further we went, you know, the longer we kept on doing shows with the great ones out there, because we were doing shows with Isaac Hayes, the Five Stair Steps, everybody. And the more I realized we was really in the thick of it, see. And so I said, well, I believe we're going to make it, you know.
Davis also recalled the enthusiastic response the Vanguards were getting from audiences around the country.
I remember crying to her because they were ripping off my ruffles off shirt and stuff. And her... I was trying to apologize to her. Herb said, no, let him take it. Let him take it. Herb, I'll get you no shirt. I didn't know that, you know, people would go that nuts, you know. Wow. Herb said, let him take it.
But the Vanguard's time together would be short-lived. In the mid-1970s, Miller walked away from Lamp Records to focus on his career as an arson investigator. The Vanguard split apart soon after, but Davis and Miller maintained their friendship.
When that was all said and done, I got James a job on the fire department, and he retired from the fire department. James and I remained friends. I was with James the day before he passed. James and I, our relationship was from beginning to end. So, you know, he was a great person and, you know, it's like losing a family member when he passed away.
James Davis was the last surviving member of the Vanguards. And when he died in 2019, most fans assumed that would be the end of the Vanguards' story. But it wasn't.
Shack in the ghetto, and my dreams to leave this old shack by the railroad. Tired of the muck and the fire,
tired of the heat and the fire.
In my work with WFYI, I've uncovered hundreds of endangered recordings of historically important Indiana music, and in 2023 I came across an unreleased demo recording from the Vanguards. The song was titled Ghetto and featured Davis on lead vocals. Earlier this year, I had a chance to play the song for Miller.
Do you remember sitting here that day with me and kind of what went through your head when you heard this song for the first time?
I love the music, and it brought back a lot of memories hearing some things that no one had ever heard and I hadn't heard forever. And, I mean, man, I've been bouncing off the sidewalk since then.
Miller is currently retired. He'll turn 85 this year, and it's been over 50 years since he shut down Lamp Records. But after hearing the song, he decided to relaunch the label with a limited edition release of the track.
Tell me about how that feels, starting this label back up again all these years later.
I feel like I'm 21, okay? Working on this. And my wife, of course, helped me, you know, put this all together. And it was just invigorating, you know. I mean, I've never been happier than this for a long time. So this was just, you know, putting this together was just great.
I'm just curious how you perceive WFYI's role in helping to promote and preserve Lamp Records, because, you know, you've been in here a lot over the last couple years, and right. So have the artists that recorded for you. How do you see the station's role in helping to preserve and promote Lamp?
Well, I think it's fantastic. I was surprised to see their interest in doing this. And, of course, with their outreach and their contact with the community, it's just phenomenal.
Because we don't have the constraints of commercial media, you know, we can cover things in more depth and cover things that might not have the same commercial appeal as you hear on other radio stations, right? With that in mind, is there anything you would say to people listening about supporting this station?
This is the place you need to be, and this is who you need to tune into, both radio and television, because you need to deal with the people that support you. And the station has really supported me. I just think it's great. They have the community in mind. And where else would you go to get the community support? No place are you going to go to get the support that you can get from WFYI.
That was Lamp Records founder Herb Miller discussing a new limited edition single featuring a lost recording from the Vanguards. And that single can be yours when you support this station at WFYI.org/give. And we'll listen to that record now. This is the Vanguards with Ghetto.
Moving out of the ghetto. I was raised in a one-room shack in the ghetto.
Ghetto!
And my dreams to leave this old shack by the railroad. Tired of the muck and the mire.
Tired of the heat and the fire.
I'm leaving my ghetto flat and I ain't coming back.
Moving out of the ghetto.
That was the Vanguards with Ghetto, a lost demo recording that I uncovered in my work producing Cultural Manifesto here at WFYI. And you can receive a limited edition 45 RPM recording of that song as a thank you gift when you support this station at WFYI.org/give. Let's join my conversation with Sid Johnson, Damon Karl, and Forecast. All right, Sid, thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me.
It's been 7 years since we last spoke. I think you were here in 2017.
Oh, my. You're the archivist, and you keep up with everything. You are like, as Babyface said to you, this is the man that knows everything. Like this guy here, he found some of my writings when I was in high school. How did he do that? Man, you're just amazing.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much. And when you were here last time, we did an exhaustive biographical interview about your history in Indianapolis music, which mm-hmm. is significant. You know, you've contributed to the scene here in many different ways. You've been a performer, working with bands like The Integrated Souls, Revolution Compared to What, The Soul Innovations, The Sid, Dwayne Rock and the Plush Band. There's a lot of them, right? You've also been a music journalist at the high school level, at the collegiate level, and professionally. You wrote for The Recorder and some alternative papers.
Yes.
You're a songwriter. You co-wrote huge hits, including Slow Jam, which was a hit for Midnight Star, Two Occasions by the Deele. You wrote songs for Shalimar, big songs. And I think most notably, you've been a manager of artists, including the legendary Manchild, a band that emerged in Indianapolis in the 1970s, a super group of funk musicians. That group launched the career of Kenny Babyface Edmonds. And you've remained, all these years, you've remained active in the Indianapolis music scene. And you're here today with a couple of the artists you currently manage, Forecast and Damon Karl. You said when we were talking about doing this interview, you wanted to talk about the past, present, and future of Indianapolis R&B.
Yes.
What do you want to share with our listeners about the past of Indianapolis R&B and your role in that?
You know, the thing that really amazes me about Indianapolis, and we don't really get the credit in this town that we should get, is that Indianapolis could have been a Detroit. It could have been a Chicago. It could have been a New York, an L.A., an Atlanta, and Miami, all of those, and the Nashville. Those are significant cities that have music scenes. But when you stop and think about it, you know, Babyface and I were having this conversation a few months ago about there is no city in America that has live, self-contained R&B bands every weekend except for Indianapolis. You know, he's asked other people as they go around, they're shocked. You know, you have cities that have DJs that play on the weekends. Or everybody knows about Music Row in Nashville, which is country and western. But there's no other city that has R&B like Indianapolis. I mean, you have the Turning Point. You have Georgia Street. You have Memories. You have OB's. Those are just a few of the clubs that I can think of that every weekend have live R&B music. And back in the day, we had more than that. We had the End Zone, the End Crowd, Zodiac Lounge, Gordy's Lounge, Mark IV, you know, Nettos. It just went on and on and on. And everybody, like, you know, you had the Vanguards and people like that. You had Bobby Watley, all of these people that cut their teeth playing around town. And not only did we have it on the weekend, but like for the Function Junction over in the Old Meadow Shopping Center and like for the Mark IV Lounge, they had music five nights a week or six nights a week, except only week they did, only day they didn't have it was on Sundays. Now it's relegated to weekends, but no other city does it like Indianapolis. And you look at all the musicians in this town, some that have made it nationally and internationally, like Babyface and like Bill Simmons of Midnight Star. And then you have people like Eric Fearman that was in the Daz Band. You have Kevin Kendricks, who went on to play with Madonna and Cameo and Andre 3000. And I hate it when I name people because I'm always going to forget somebody. But there are a lot of people that are doing it on a national or international level. But guess where they come from? Indianapolis. You know, Bootsy used to always make comments about you can go to Indianapolis and get yourself a whole band. And that's the truth. I mean, this town has a plethora of bass players, a plethora of keyboard players, and they're all very good. And when they don't play on the R&B circuit, guess what they do? They're playing in churches on Sunday. And some of them, that's their only job, because those churches pay them a nice salary to play music. But R&B is where they cut their teeth. So what I feel that makes Indianapolis unique is that it is a musical breeding ground. And that's what I think happened way back in the late 50s, the 60s, the 70s, and we've gone forward. Unfortunately, thanks to the advent of disco in the 80s, the live music scene kind of died a little bit because club owners kind of thought, it's a little bit cumbersome dealing with bands, and it's cheaper to just get a DJ to play. And then you had the R&B of the 90s that came with Boyz II Men, Jodeci, Drew Hill, 112, Next, H-Town, all of those kind of groups. And then R&B started to gain a little bit more feeling, but also in the 90s, hip-hop really started to take over. So R&B was trying, but hip-hop was winning. Now I find that we have people wanting to go back down memory lane. Many of the hip-hoppers love R&B. They will cite some of the old school R&B people as their favorite music artists. Obviously, we know they sample a lot of the music from that, from those eras of time. This is what I think makes Indianapolis significant, is that we have so many musicians here that are versatile and that I can do the job. I mean, you look at Babyface, who took Brian Thompson from this town and put him in his band. You know, DG that plays with Downstroke, he played on the road with After Seven for a while. Then you have, who else is playing somebody? Greg Russell from Downstroke. He went out on tour with After Seven. There's a bass player that's playing currently right now with, he's Mariah Carey's bass player. He's from Indianapolis. There are just so many things that Indianapolis has to offer in terms of live music. And that started a long time ago. And my goal is to try to keep the tradition going. I kind of had my hand in a lot of the things. I've worked with literally everybody on the scene in one capacity or another. Either I've co-written or written a tune for them, produced them, managed them, consulted them, put them on a show. It's really amazing. It's just something about Indianapolis, and I just wish I could even do more. But I'm glad that I have carried on with what I've done, because it leads to discovering people like Damon Karl and discovering people like Forecast.
Before we move on to the present day Indianapolis R&B scene, I wanted to give our listeners an example of your work as a songwriter. Is there a song from your catalog that you're particularly proud of that you would want me to share that represents what you do as a songwriter and lyricist as well?
That would have to be Slow Jam, because that was the first placement that Kenny and I had on a national act, and it was totally my concept. Without me, there would not have been a song called Slow Jam. Yeah, that would be the one.
Well, let's listen to Midnight Star performing Slow Jam, co-written by our guest this week, Sid Johnson.
I asked her for a hand, said, would you like to dance? So pleased that I had asked, she quickly took my hand, and we danced and fell in love on a slow jam.
Cultural Manifesto will return after this short break.
WFYI podcast brought to you by Bloomington, Indiana, an American college town offering food and drink, college sports, outdoor activities, live music, cool art, and good times daily. Everyone is welcome in Bloomington. More information at visitbloomington.com.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. We just heard Slow Jam by Midnight Star, a classic R&B anthem co-written by our guest, Sid Johnson. You co-wrote that song with Babyface, right?
Yes.
Here in Indianapolis.
Yes.
And Sid, we've been talking about the
46 and Keystone.
Okay.
Yes.
The exact address.
Yes, I remember
the
house.
There should be a plaque there.
There should be.
We've been talking about the past of Indianapolis R&B. We're going to talk about the present now. And we're here with a couple artists you currently manage, Forecast and Damon Karl. Before we join our conversation with them, I wanted to ask you just a general question about the present day R&B scene in Indianapolis. A lot of big acts are coming out of the city now. Tierra Thomas, Maita, Hannah Benn, I don't know if you know her, George Benn from Merging Traffic's daughter. She was on the recent Michelle and Degge Ocello album, an incredible artist. How do you see the contemporary scene here in Indianapolis for R&B?
I see as people like Brian Thompson, who's really more smooth jazz, but he plays in Babyface's band, and with Maita and with Tierra, that makes people take a look and like, oh, you're from Indianapolis? And then people connect those dots and they say, isn't that where Babyface is from? So it's like kind of like, maybe there's more of that? And what I say is, there is more of that here. Unfortunately, the music industry is different than the way it used to be. And if it was the way it used to be, I think we would have Indianapolis as another Detroit. But we got to make it do what it does to do what it do in the new way that we do music. And that's what I'm going to definitely be a part of.
Yeah. Yeah. And Damon, I don't know if you can see me, but there's a lot of people in the studio today.
Yeah.
I want to talk to you next. Mm-hmm. You were here, I think, in 2018. And you were just starting your music career at that time.
Right, right.
You've done a lot since then. You've released several singles. You've toured across the country. You've played some big shows, some with Babyface. Tell us what you've been up to in the last 5 years, 6 years since you were here.
Well, I think you can kind of see the work in my music. Mostly I've been working on a few of my singles that I've dropped recently and, just opening up shows for Babyface, which is an incredible, honor. And to Sid Johnson, Uncle Jams, he orchestrated that. So thanks to him, it's just been wonderful,
I remember when you were here, you told me that classic R&B and soul music has been a big inspiration for you. I think you mentioned The Spinners, Aretha Franklin. What is it about that music that speaks to you, and how does that incorporate itself into the music you make today?
I mean, the proof is kind of in the, the pudding. I mean, you just listen to it and listen to the music, and it's still that inspiration is still in my head.
Yeah, yeah. It's just part of who you are,
yes.
And it comes out organically
Absolutely.
In your music. We were talking about the classic R&B scene in Indianapolis. And one of the major figures to come out of Indianapolis was Reggie Griffin. He was a founder of Manchild and later went on to produce huge records for Sugar Hill in New Jersey, like The Message by Grandmaster Flash. He also produced I Feel For You by Shaquan. He's worked with the Isley Brothers and so many other legends of American music. Damon, he wrote your recent single, Don't Wake Me Up If I'm Dreaming. Right. Tell me about working with Reggie and tell me about this track. We're going to listen to it, but tell us about the track before we hear it.
Well, about the track, it kind of explains itself. Don't wake me up if I'm dreaming. You know, you're in love with someone, and you don't want to be woken up from this feeling of being in love so much. But working with Reggie, he's a tough one. But, you know, it's a wonderful experience because he makes you work. He brings out the best in you. So, I mean, it's a wonderful experience to work with him.
What was tough about it? I only know him as someone I've interviewed. I've never seen him at work musically in the studio. What was tough about it?
Well, you got to think. If you don't have one part, he's going to make you do it over and over and over again until you get that one part right. So think about that over the span of like a few days of trying to get this single. And, you know, by that time, I'm like, okay, I'm finished. I'm done. But no, he's a stickler about it, and he will make sure that the, whatever's coming from him will be the best.
He's a perfectionist, I
Absolutely.
Take it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, let's listen to that track now. This is Don't Wake Me Up If I'm Dreaming, written by Reggie Griffin.
Sometimes it seems to me I'm living in a dream, a perfect fantasy. There's nowhere I'd rather be. Don't wake me up if I'm dreaming. I found the love of someone sweet as you. Don't wake me up if I'm dreaming.
I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. We just heard Don't Wake Me Up If I'm Dreaming by Damon Karl. Damon is one of my guests this week. We're here with Sid Johnson, Forecast, and Damon Karl. And Forecast, I want to move on to you now. Yeah, pass the mic. It's crowded in here.
Yes, sir.
First, can everyone just go around and introduce themselves so our listeners can get a sense of your voice?
Yes, sir. How are you guys doing? My name is Cjayy.
I'm Shaq Diesel.
And I'm Al Wayne.
Tell me how you came together. I think, Shaq, you told me that did you all go to Warren Central High School, or did that school play a role in the formation?
It was just me and Cjayy.
Yeah, I went to Broad Ripple. This is Al Wayne. I went to Broad Ripple.
How did you all come together?
Well, man, it was just a cumulative of things. So, as Diesel said, we went to Warren together, and we started an R&B group, and we, you know, was kind of doing that, and then some things happened, and, you know, we kind of went our different ways, and then I've been knowing Al pretty much my whole life, you know what I mean? So, you know, he's been doing the live band scene for so many, you know, years and stuff like that, and I was kind of doing the, you know, R&B scene and, you know, just stuff like that with the music videos and stuff like that. So he allowed me to join the band. We sung together, and then Diesel started coming to the shows, and it just so happened that we found out that they were related. So once we found that out, it was kind of icing on the cake, and then here we are. Hmm.
Shaq, you told me that you also sang in a quartet in church. I'm curious about the harmony, the vocal harmony in your sound. I think that's something that's missing from a lot of contemporary music. You know, back in the day, the rock bands, the soul bands, the pop acts, harmony was a big part of the sound of American music, and it added so much richness and depth. I love that you guys are bringing that back in your work. Tell me about the sound of your group as vocalists and why you decided to bring that in. Was the church an influence?
Absolutely. The church was definitely an influence. I think all of us got a little bit of church background. But I would say that, you know, our harmonies are they're very unique in a sense. We all have we all complement each other's voices, so it kind of makes it a natural flow for us.
You want to add anything?
I mean, yeah, definitely. We all, you know, like Big Bro said, you know, come from that church background, but we also come from R&B background as well, you know, from the Temptations and Smokey Robinson and OJs and, like Uncle Sid said earlier, Boyz II Men and New Edition and Jodeci. So what we all do is just kind of come together and kind of put our minds together and figure out what we can do to, you know, kind of make our harmonies different and stand out. Because like you said earlier, there's not a lot of harmonies in songs and R&B and stuff like that anymore. So definitely just trying to incorporate that back into it.
Absolutely.
What kind of reaction does that get from audiences when you're out performing? Are they happy to hear this sound? It's different, right, than probably some of the acts you're performing with.
Yeah, they definitely love the sound, because what it is you don't see a lot of people doing, you know, what we do. You know what I mean? What we try to do is at our shows and in our music, and what we do is try to give you something to, you know, make you feel good, make you feel like you want to get up and dance and sing along and stuff like that. So definitely we get some good reviews. Now, there are some critics, right? But we get good reviews. We definitely do.
Who are the critics? What are they saying? That's
haters.
Old school? Or
haters.
We don't run from constructive criticism, but sometimes it'd be a little hate in there. But we love it. We take it with a grain of salt, and we keep pushing.
You know, I was talking with Sid about the current R&B scene here in Indianapolis, some of the big artists that have come out of the city. You guys are in the thick of it. Tell me about the scene here today.
Yeah, we've been doing this. Well, I've been doing this for, I would say, 7 years. And I was raised into this music scene, like Uncle Sid said, from the man. My father grew up in the Man Child days, the Zodiac days, the Deele days. He played in some of those bands in those clubs. And when I kind of grew up, you know, I kind of took the you know, the baton. He passed it on to me, and you know, I started to do the live music. The live music scene here in Indianapolis is, like Uncle Sid said, is very, very unique. You don't get this kind of R&B scene in any other city. And I'm real fortunate to, you know, be a part of this city, because, you know, it's great. You know, we can perform at a plethora of clubs around Indianapolis. And the promoters are great. The people that come out, they really support us. They love us. It's a wonderful experience.
Yeah, and to definitely piggyback on Big Brother, there's so many dope artists and so many dope bands here in Indy. You know, you got, like Uncle said, you don't want to name them all because you don't want to, you know, miss any. But there's so many people, just to name a few, like Miss Leah Rowe. You got people like Jamal White. You got people like Mr. Monte. You got people like DK, of course, Miss Kelsey Marie, Skip 12, so many people that's just, you know what I mean, on the music scene and really doing great. And not even just the bands, like you got Cool Beans and Tony Bryan Project and, you know, Bomb Squad, and just so many other different people, Tamika Key Project, so many different people that's keeping that music scene going good. So, it's definitely going good.
Yeah, and now I want to play your single, Girl, You Good. This song is getting a lot of traction, right?
Yes, sir.
It's been doing well.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Tell me about the single and the response you've been getting.
We recorded in Atlanta with Nutbush. Shout out to Zoomies. We recorded, you know, and it was different for me. It was my first time recording with a legendary producer. Shout out to Nutbush. And then day after, we meet legendary Babyface in Greenville, yeah. South Carolina. Yeah. So yeah. It was definitely one for the books weekend, for sure.
Anything you wanted to add?
Girl, You Good is a beautiful song. It really speaks to making, you know, securing your girl, you know, making sure that she's okay. Us as entertainers, we travel a lot, you know, we're busy, we're always on the road. So, you know, we want to make sure that our girl is secure at home. If you got a girl, you know. But that's what that song speaks to. We all wrote on it. Me, Shaq, Cjayy, Uncle Sid, and Bush, we all wrote on it. So I think we did a great job.
Yeah, before we listen, I just want to say I love that all this Damon single, your single, it all comes back to some of these legendary figures in Indianapolis music. You mentioned Nutbush, who produced the track. He was in Dose of Soul, right? A legendary R&B group from Indianapolis that had a big hit. They were on the Nutty Professor soundtrack. He's also part of the Bush family. Chucky Bush from Manchild, Aretha Bush, nephew, legendary jazz singer. Well, let's listen to that track. This is Forecast with Girl, You Good.
And if you didn't know, I don't have no problem saying it.
Forever.
That was Forecast with Girl You Good. I'm Kyle Long, and you're listening to Cultural Manifesto. I'm joined by Forecast, Damon Karl, and Sid Johnson. And I want to bring everyone into the conversation now, sort of a group discussion for the future of R&B music in Indianapolis. We've been talking about the past and present. What is the future of the scene here? We talked about the people coming out of the city. Is that going to translate into some serious music business happening here? Sid, did you want to start it off?
Yeah, I think that what's going to be good for the city is more collaborations. And Damon and Forecast, they perform together sometimes on a couple of numbers. And they're in October, they're going to be performing in Cincinnati for a cerebral palsy benefit. And he's going to do a few songs solo. They're going to do a few songs. Then they're going to do a few songs together. There's some other things on the drawing board. And I'm making a special announcement tonight for your show. There's a song that Kenny Edmonds wrote and produced on the singer Karen White called Love Saw It from her big album. And it was a duet she did with Babyface. Karen White is going to be performing at the Indiana Black Expo Outdoor Summer Concert in June. And normally there's this singer named O'Brien who had some hits back in the 80s. And he comes out with Karen White and does the duet with her when she performs live. But he's unavailable on June 28th. So a connection put Karen White's manager in touch with me and said that he heard that I had a guy that could get that Babyface vibe, blah, 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 so forth and so on. And he was referring to this kid called Damon Karl. And he said, could you send me his stuff so I can let Karen hear it? And I sent it. It wasn't 24 hours later. He said, Karen wants Damon to duet with her on Love Saw It at the Indiana Black Expo Outdoor Concert.
Congrats, Damon. Anything you want to say about that?
Right, what I'm saying right now, I had no words. You know, it's an incredible honor to sing with a legend, of course. And, you know, of course you get all the nerves and everything. So I'm kind of, even though it's a little bit far away, but every day I think about it and I'm like, okay, all right, just kind of calm your nerves down.
Congrats, and I called Kenny and told him, he said, tell Damon he better do me good.
Yeah, if that doesn't add to it.
Damon. And also another announcement I want to make. Forecast is going to be one of the headline acts at the Madam Walker Legacy Center Block Party Festival on June the 22nd.
Mm-hmm. Congrats. That's very cool. Yeah, playing on the Avenue.
Appreciate it.
Forecast, Damon, any opinions, thoughts you want to share about the future of R&B music in Indianapolis? Is there still time for this to be in Atlanta or Detroit?
First of all, I want to say shout out to the M.E.C.A.P. label.
Yes, sir.
It's hard being under a legendary producer songwriter, but shout out to the label. We gonna be coming this summer with we got singles from Damon Karl, Forecast, 12. Shout out to Kelsey Marie, Stars of Mazar, all them. T Hill, Sase. Am I missing some people?
Everybody just
Shout out to M.E.C.A.P. Yeah, but we all gonna be coming in the summertime. We got dates. Forecast got dates coming out. We'll be hitting the road soon and all that. Just be looking out.
Yeah, definitely. And to kind of piggyback on your question, man, I feel like my honest opinion is people just need to be original. Be who you are. You know what I mean? Because one thing about us that we pride ourselves on is being original and being who we feel like we are. You know what I mean? Because a lot of people get caught up in so many no's. You know what I mean? And so many people, you know, not agreeing with what you do or how you do it or how you sing, how you write, whatever the case may be, but all it takes is one yes, right? So in a situation like that, just continue to just be yourself, be positive, stay humble, right? And then when the successes and all that stuff start coming to you, learn how to, you know, maintain it and just handle it.
Anyone else?
People are hungry. People are hungry for R&B. R&B never died. It's still here. People still play, you know, the oldies and the goodies. People still play and sing along with the 90s music. And all we're going to do is we're just going to tap into that energy and push it into the future.
Damon, any final thoughts? Any thoughts on the future of R&B?
Yeah, the question that you asked is, you know, is there, you know, future of R&B? But there's shoes that need to be filled coming from Indianapolis. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of R&B artists and, you know, in Indianapolis, of course. But you have to think there's a lot of legends come from Indianapolis, and those shoes have to be filled by the up and coming artist or the, you know, the the greats. So I think there is a bright future for Indianapolis.
I think this collaborative thing that I was talking about for NBA All-Star Weekend, Gino had an event down at the Slippery Noodle that I curated, and I had a bunch of R&B artists there, like Tamika Key and Kia Benberry from the Unit Band and Leah Rowe and Skull Nixon and Forecast and Damon and Kelsey all performed, and I think
Ali
and then I had some hip hoppers too with Skip and 12, and I think this collaboration thing is what's going to do it, because everybody had such a good time with that. You know, back in the days of the Motown thing, you know, Kyle, how you had the Temptations, the Supremes, the Four Tops, Junior Walker and the All-Stars, the Contours, the Vibrations, Mary Wells, Marvin Gaye. All of those people used to go out on the road together. They would collaborate and do a Motown review, and then they would have duets, you know, like Diana Ross and Marvin Gaye did a duets album. The Four Tops and the Temptations have done things, Diana and the Temptations. And I think that's going to be the kind of thing, because that's what happened in hip-hop. You had more collaborations, and many times I think in R&B people kind of get a little egocentric, and it's not an alone thing. It's a together thing, mm-hmm. And I think that's what ultimately is going to keep it going, because we got to do something a little different. There's nothing wrong with R&B, but let's just expand it, because people love R&B. Like, I have found out there are some trends in streaming now, where originally it was these younger people, these younger R&B artists that, in my opinion, it's not really R&B that they do, but they call it R&B. But they were the ones getting the big streaming numbers. But now there's been a big uptick in catalog R&B music, like the OJs, the Whispers, Babyface, Teddy Pendergrass, Jeffrey Osborne, Stephanie Mills. That's starting to really pick up now, because the older people now are learning cassettes are not coming back. CDs are not really coming back, and only the serious rock music collectors and jazz collectors are into vinyl. So you got to get with the times. You got to stream if you want to hear the music. So the older people, 50 and above, are now starting to learn how to stream, or realizing that's what they have to do. So I think it's going to be healthy. It's still fluid. It's still a work in progress. But I'm going to do everything I can to make R&B stay alive in Indianapolis, if it kills me. Because I believe that people need to be a sponge when they're around me. Because I'm getting older, and I'm not going to be able to, I don't know if I'll do this as long as Barry Gordy and Quincy Jones. But maybe. I don't know. When I found out those guys are in their 90s, I'm like, ooh, could I see myself in the studio with Damon Karl when I'm 90? I don't know about that one.
You got it.
Because it's really rough being in the studio with him now while I'm 37. But anyway.
You mean 27?
I thank you all for being here. Any final thoughts anyone wants to share before we go?
Keep streaming, girl. You're good. Stream No Problem. Stream Hold On. Forecast. We got more music on the way.
Definitely. And as I always say, spread love, spread positivity. There's too much negativity in the world to continue to keep being negative, and always take care of your mental health, because mental health is a real thing too as well.
Anybody else, Damon?
We'll give a shout out to you, Kyle Long.
Oh, yes, sir.
All that you do.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Nothing is really possible.
Appreciate you having us.
Thank you for having
us. Thank you. Final song. What should we end with? Sid, do you want to pick a final track before we go? Put you on the spot. Throw a track for us.
I think that we have too many people that are not real. There's too many fake people, too many haters. So how about Shalamar's Games?
Which you co-wrote, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Sid, Damon, CJ, Al, Shaq. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The day I called them my friends are having on my way. I thought he was someone that I could trust, but I must have been asking just a little too much. Before I could even leave my room, I was the talk of the town by the afternoon.
That's all the time we have for this week. Thank you to my guests, Sid Johnson, Damon Karl, and Forecast. Check out the Cultural Manifesto podcast at WFYI.org or wherever you listen to podcasts. And please consider supporting WFYI's spring membership drive at WFYI.org/give. Cultural Manifesto is hosted and produced by me, Kyle Long. Thank you for listening.
Are you interested in reaching the WFYI audience while supporting the programming you love? Become a sponsor today. Learn more at WFYI.org/sponsor.